Here we go.
Good morning, everyone. Before I begin today, I want to let you know that for the title of my sermon, I'm going to be talking about death and dying and hospitals, and these can be difficult topics for anyone to hear. So please know that if you need to leave this sermon at any time, it's okay. I promise I won't be offended. And we have members of the care ministry here today. They have tags on their name tags, and they'll be in the commons and the during coffee hour if you need some support. I'm a PhD student at UNC, which means that I did half of med school, stopped, and now I'm currently in grad school. And once I get my PhD, I'll go back and finish med school. Basically, I chose this very circuitous path because I really like school, and I really hate making decisions. I realized that I wanted to be a doctor when I was in high school. As a cancer survivor myself, I knew what it was like to be a patient. Plus, I was, and continue to this day, to be a giant science nerd. I previously became really interested in human dissection, in part because of its weird history. Previously, dissection was performed as a punishment in Western society. But other cultures interpreted donating one's body for medical training to be the highest honor, bestowing a title of teacher to the donor. There's now a shift in many medical schools across the country from using the term cadavers to calling them donors. I really like this because cadaver isn't something that you choose. Donor implies a choice, and that really is what it is. It's choosing to get a gift. On the first day of my anatomy lab, which I've been participating for many years, I walked into a small room with my fellow students. The first day, there would be no anatomy lessons, no scalpels, no books. That day, we would just meet our donor. This was the first time I had ever seen a dead body, and I still had that horror movie instinct in me, that dead bodies are to be feared, that they're dangerous. Which, of course, they aren't. That day, the thing that pulled me out of the horror movie vibe of walking into a cinder block room with a drain in the floor and a body on the table was the pink fingernail polish on my donor. That made me remember that my donor was a person, and she gave us her body so that we could learn. Sometime during the course of class, I dreamed about her. I dreamed that she was helping me, showing me where to cut and what to look for. She told me that it was okay, that she was okay, and that she wanted to help me learn. To this day, whenever I think of the sciatic nerve, I think of hers. Whenever I think of the muscles and tendons in the hand, I think of her hands. And whenever I think of the vessels of the heart, I remember her heart. At the end of the last anatomy lab, I stayed behind a moment. I looked at my donor, whom I got to know inside and out, and thanked her because she truly gave me a gift. When I started working in the hospital, I was exposed not just to death, but to dying patients. My first clinical rotation in the hospital was inpatient medical oncology. This is where cancer patients go when they're too sick to go home. The goal here is not to cure their cancer, but to make sure that they're well enough so that they can go home and then continue their cancer treatment. Death, as you can imagine, was a frequent point of discussion. We often had to have difficult conversations with patients and their families about the state of their cancer and what we should do about it. I found that you can tell the really good doctors. They are the ones who will always position themselves at the eye level. This often would mean sitting in their clean business clothes with their starched white coats on the floor of the hospital room so that they could look into the eyes of the patient in the hospital bed. I heard one doctor describe palliative care as a last gift that the family can give to a patient. It's a gift of mercy and of love. Let me explain exactly what I mean when I say palliative care. Palliative we do for the common cold, decongestants, NyQuil, all of that, that's technically palliative care. Because the goal is to manage the symptoms, the stuffy nose, the aches, the sore throat, rather than to do anything about the virus itself. Palliative care does not mean giving up. It means shifting priorities. We continue to fight just as hard, but now we're not fighting to cure the disease. We're fighting to make sure that today is the best day it can be for you. I think that's really beautiful, the idea of fighting for today. My mom has actually nicknamed me the Death Princess, because I'm really cheerful and bizarrely enthusiastic about palliative care. Like, you know the Disney princesses and Belle Love's books, and she's all about cuisine, and Moana has the ocean, and they all say animated animals from it? It's like me, except with palliative care. I'm about to see animals, usually. Studies have shown that adding palliative care specialists to a medical team may not only improve quality of care, but may also improve survival. Even if that is not the stated goal. A study in 2010 from Massachusetts General had two groups of patients. One group got usual oncology care, and the other got oncology care plus a palliative care specialist. In the group that had a palliative care specialist, patients stopped chemo earlier, entered hospice care earlier, reported experiencing less suffering, and lived 25% longer. I'm going to repeat that. The patients who had access to a palliative care specialist lived 25% longer. Studies have shown that life-limiting illnesses tend to shift priorities. According to Dr. Bawande, the top priorities for these patients include avoiding suffering, strengthening relationships with family and friends, being mentally aware, not being a burden on others, and achieving a sense that their life is complete. Dr. Bawande describes the difficult process of going through these hard discussions with his own father, who is also a doctor, following his cancer diagnosis. He asks those same four questions that the palliative care specialist Susan Block asked her own father. Do you understand what is happening? What are your concerns about the future? What are your goals, and what trade-offs are you? His father understood that his cancer was causing him to slowly become paralyzed. He was worried that he was losing the ability to care for himself and was becoming a burden on his family. His goal was to finish his community service work and ensure that his family and the college he had set up would continue to do well. However, unlike Susan Block's father, Dr. DeWando's father wouldn't be satisfied with watching football and eating chocolate ice cream. The thing that was most important to him was interacting with people, but not if he could not breathe or eat on his own. Let me die instead, his father said. Dr. Duarte explains that those questions were among the hardest he asked in his life, but afterwards, both he and his father felt relief and clarity. Later, when his father was in surgery to try to slow the tumor's growth and the course of paralysis, there were complications in the operating room. The surgeon came out to talk to Dr. Bawande and his family about whether they should proceed. And like Susan Block, Dr. Bawande knew what his father wanted. He was more afraid of total paralysis than of dying. So he asked the surgeons which option was more likely to result in total paralysis. The surgeon said he would be more likely to avoid paralysis with surgery. So they need to go ahead to continue. Later on in the recovery room after the surgery, one of the doctors reported that there was no major loss in his ability to move. With a breathing tube still in his mouth, Dr. Bawande's father couldn't talk, but upon hearing this, he spelled out in the air, happy. Bawande knew what was important to his father, and because of this, his father was essentially able to influence decisions about his own care, even while sedated on the operating room table. Simply asking these questions about how we want the end of life to look can make the whole process easier. La Crosse, Wisconsin, is spending half as many days in the last 6 months in life in the hospital, and their life expectancy is a year longer. In 1991, local medical leaders campaigned to get patients to talk about their end-of-life wishes with their medical providers. All patients admitted to the hospital or to an assisted living facility were asked four crucial questions. One, if your heart stops, do you want to be resuscitated? Two, if you are unable, do you want a machine to breathe for you? Three, do you want antibiotics? And four, if you are unable to eat on your own, do you want a feeding tube? Within 5 years, 85% of residents in this town who died had an advance directive with this information, compared to 15%. This means that a lot of these crucial questions were asked while a patient was still relatively healthy, before entering the stressed and fast-paced environment of the intensive care unit, where all decisions must be made quickly. While the answers to these questions may change throughout a patient's life, it means that the families in this town were more accustomed to having these conversations. And that means that before a crisis strikes, patients have their wishes down on paper in their files. Our church community has a lot of resources around end-of-life planning. For example, Carolyn Holtz and Ivy Brazan led numerous workshops and have created a powerful legacy checklist document that's available through the church office. And there are now even websites that can help you, such as joincape.com, deathandcape. These start by asking simple questions like, do you want your Facebook deleted? And they'll go as far as helping you make advanced care plans and store documents that designate who can make healthcare decisions for you in the case that you're unable to make it for yourself. It's easier to make these decisions and have these discussions while everyone is still healthy, hopefully months or years before these decisions come into effect. In medical school, I took a class called Death and Dying in America. While we were discussing advanced directives in the context of caring for our patients, our professor pointed out that this was an excellent excuse to have these conversations with our own families. It's sometimes easier to start these conversations if you can point to something like a class or maybe a sermon, perhaps, that told you to do so, so it doesn't just seem like you're thinking about and planning for your healthy relative's death. So that fall, my parents and I went to Disneyland, and while we had dinner on Main Street, watching the twinkle lights turn on in the shadow of the castle, I asked them, so I'm taking this class about death and dying. And my professor said we should talk to our families about their end-of-life wishes. Can we talk about this? And I went through that list from the cross, Wisconsin, about if your heart stops or if you can't breathe on your own. I asked them what they want me to do with their bodies. After hearing how impactful my anatomy lab donor was on me, both of my parents told me that they wanted to donate their bodies to medical schools so some other scared and humbling medical students could learn. The discussion actually wasn't nearly as scary as you'd expect. And then after we had this long discussion about death, we went on the Buzz Lightyear Astroblaster tour. So, yeah, I had my discussion with my parents about end-of-life care at Disneyland. I told you I was a death princess. I'm agnostic, so I'm not even going to try to get into anything about the afterlife, but I will say this a little bit. I once talked to a palliative care nurse who drew on her Catholic faith in the care of her patients. She told me that nearly every patient she cared for had some experience close to the time of their death where they saw someone they loved who had already died. Now, I can't know exactly what they were experiencing, but it seems to me like there are two general explanations. One, their loved one loved them so much they came back to help this person cross over so they wouldn't be afraid. That the love was so impactful that even beyond the grave, that patient's brain manifested that love in the form of a vision. Both explanations show how much we continue to love even after our loved ones leave us. go through to experience that. There are no right or wrong answers. These are all hard questions, but they are essential. Because what I'm really asking you is how you want to live.